sucker punch. Not really. But you killed it. We got a codex entry for Corpuscular Maw. Alright. Let's check out this codex entry then. See if there's anything new. Anything new about Artaglio? Nope. Nothing new. Bloom sleeves. Alright. Foreman. It's like it feels like ages ago since we were over there doing things in Sega's cliffs. Saria, that's the girl's name I was trying to remember. Saria and what's her name? Choi are in my mind. Now joined by Artaglio, so I guess whenever I die I get to see him. Silver orphans. Okay. So we've encountered new areas. What was the name of that one? The Gullet? Well, it's not under the. This stuff should not be. It should say steadfast, comma, the, or something like that. And be put in order. Yeah, we don't have one on the Gullet. And where are we now? The bone? Chamber of Bones? Do you have anything on the Chamber of Bones? I don't think so. I would have noticed it. Nope. No Chamber of Bones. Unless under the Chamber of Bones. Nope. Corpuscular Maw. Sometimes the Bloom's Maws break free of its body and fragment into smaller, autonomous creatures. These ravenous horrors are known as Corpuscular Maws. They consist of a small central core containing a tiny portal to another time or place surrounded by knots of bloom flesh that form into arms and tendrils. The arms serve as a means of locomotion as well as attack. Yeah, that's it. Okay. Anything new in a journal? Okay, we can interact with a few things here. There's a skull. Cool. Oh, wow. I didn't notice that. We got a skull and an arm, hand going on here. This is... apparently its belly? We're standing in where its chest would be.
Yes.
Whatever this creature was, its stomach was enormous. The organ pulsates, distended with gas, and something else rumbles in the depths, as if trapped. Foul acidic juices ooze from torn holes in the viscera. It hisses and steams when it drips onto bloom flesh. Do I really want to paste my ear against this rotting stomach? Ew, I don't want to do that either. Reach into the innards. Place your ear against the stomach to listen. Something inside the creature's guts is thrashing about. This is not the sound of decay. It's the sound of desperation. You can still hear something thrashing about in the creature's guts. Reach into the innards and try to release whatever is trapped inside. 85%. What? You thrust your arms into various holes in the rotting organs. Bile and stomach acids burn your flesh, but you find nothing. When the pain becomes overwhelming, you stumble away. Took 3 damage. Can we try again?
No.
We will try someone else who can get to 100%, hopefully. Tiberhan. He doesn't have a lot of speed, though, does he? Oh, it's just gonna drain him all the way down. Let's have Aretas do it. You reach into the holes in the viscera. It should be Aretas getting damaged, thank you. Shoving your arms through rotting intestines, gritting your teeth against the burning pain of the acids and bile within. Finally, you feel dim movement, and you thrust your arms even deeper into the stomach, immersing yourself to the shoulder. Oh my god, I'll be puking right now. A questing tendril touches your hand. Instinctively, you try to withdraw, but the tendril wraps tight around your wrist. Its touch is unmistakable. The thing that was trapped in the stomach is a maw. More tendrils grab onto your hand, pulling their way toward freedom. Bloom tongues rip through decaying intestines, spraying stomach juices in every direction. Good God. Then the great mouth appears, bursting through the dead flesh. Its tendrils sink into the viscera, anchoring itself in place. You realize that the maw must have been feeding on something in the creature's stomach, because it's already sated. Its orifice opens wide, and a portal appears. Where the hell does this go? To the forgotten niche. What? You're finding more and more. Alright, let's mess with the head thing then.
Before we leave.
The head of this creature was truly massive, though the flesh has been eaten away, probably by the same corpuscular maws that attacked you. Based on how those things are, it would take them forever to do it, because they are not strong or effective, really. Parts of the skull are missing, revealing a huge glistening brain. An organic sheath still encases the brain, and it looks as if the brain's cranial juices have protected it from serious decomposition. Examine the brain. The brain's sheath hasn't decayed, though a strange and pungent smell emanates from it. Perhaps that's why the corpuscular maws left the brain alone. Its tissues don't seem to be badly damaged. Healing? The creature is thoroughly dead, there's no doubt about that, but the preservation of the brain means that some of its memories could still be intact. A powerful infusion of tidal energy might bring the brain back to life, at least for a while. Interesting. The sorrow doesn't like that, though. A membrane that surrounds the brain has kept it preserved, even though the body is dead. Let's try to restore activity to the brain. Whoa. Blue tide raised a moderate amount. Yes, because we must know. We must have knowledge. You concentrate on the flux and pull of the tides within you, and you send them surging out into the creature's dead mind. Its neck jerks a bit as a simulacrum of life floods into its brain stem. You can see arcs of movement, small ripples in its surface. The monster is still thoroughly dead, but its brain reacts to the power you've spilled into it. Several clusters of nerves at the base of the brain begin twitching spasmodically. They may still be connected to other parts of the creature's body. But if it's reacting, is it truly dead? Examine the nerve clusters at the base of the brain. Your knowledge of healing helps you trace and understand the function of these nerves. It seems that a good many of them are still functional and are associated with bodily functions. One cluster attaches to the shoulder, and another attaches to the back. A third cluster runs down to the intestines. Something in the brain is sending and receiving impulses along the tattered nerves. You might be able to manipulate the entire corpse from here. Really? First, we'll try to scan the brain's thoughts. The dead creature's thoughts are disjointed and confused. Its final memories flash into your mind. The slate and fuchsia sky above you threatens another spate of the oily slurry it has regurgitated for the past 1,000 years. The sky above you. It's going to release kind of oil kind of stuff. Hunger tears your belly, the first signs of impending starvation. You have ruled these vast lands for the centuries of your life, torn your supremacy from the throats of all those who would challenge you. And yet, something has changed. The very air has torn asunder, creating a floating rift that leads to another place, a place that smells of raw flesh. You dive into the rift, suddenly finding yourself in a very different place, a paradise where everything is made of meat. Ravenous, you heave yourself toward the nearest wall of flesh, scattering a horde of tiny two-legged creatures that aren't worth a moment's attention. You tear chunks from the wall, chewing and swallowing. The meat is tough and foul-tasting, but it's food, and you're starving. That must be the bloom. Everything is made of meat. You eat and eat, carving your way through the wall, and fall into another chamber. You see a protuberance of flesh nearby, surrounded by wriggling tendrils. It looks delicious, so you tear from the wall and swallow it whole. Oh my god. Delicious. The entire world shakes. More little creatures spill from the walls, but these have lashing tendrils and shining maws. They fall upon you, chewing and annihilating, and you bellow in pain. The world shakes again, and the whole chamber collapses upon you, trapping you, holding you fast as the little monsters devour you, bite by bite. Your death is long and agonizing. That's horrible. The poor guy just wanted to eat. Damn. He's going to be surrounded and encased by the very world of flesh that he was trying to eat. The vision fades and you are alone with the beast. Manipulate the shoulder nerves. I'm not sure what this is going to accomplish. One shoulder and massive arm of the creature shifts slightly. The decomposed limb appears to tighten its grip on the bloom flesh, but it quickly relaxes again. The back nerves. Ooh. The whole back of the corpse contracts and heaves. Chunks of rotting flesh tumble to the ground, and you hear a wet snap as nerve fibers separate somewhere in the spine. You won't be able to try that again. Okay. Manipulate the intestinal nerves. The maw grumbles fitfully, but nothing else happens. Alright. I guess that would have been another way to release the maw, if we hadn't already. I can move further this way. But for no purpose. I cannot go there. Okay. I'm gonna save again. I feel it's a good idea to save before you go through a maw like that. Excuse me. Just checking. And we seem to be good. Okay, through into the forgotten niche. Or niche.
Yes, now.
However you want to say it. We're going there now. Yes, and stuff. What goodies will we find within? Another skeleton. Small area. Forgotten niche. What's that? Skeletal corpse. Okay. Let's get this loot.
Fine.
71 shins and a liquid armor. Ooh, only usable by the last cast off. Let's check that out. 4 armor, 6 resistance. This is actual armor. We got 3 and 4. Yeah, 4 and 6. Much better. Unfortunately, not with the +1 intellect pool, but we have plenty of intellect. This armor is stored inside 3 strong glass containers, attached to an ordinary belt. When activated, the cylinders open, and the liquid flows in across the user's chest, arms, and legs, forming a lightweight and surprisingly durable armor. Due to its fluid nature, this liquid armor is far less restrictive than other forms of protection. It can be worn over very light garments. It can only be worn over very light garments, or the armor won't take shape properly. My machinery lore reveals that some less than reputable scholars have claimed that the liquid is in fact sentient and refuses to come in contact with any other protective garment, which it views as inferior to itself. Even though no one has been able to provide any evidence for this theory, it is surprisingly resilient. This shows that even the most brilliant researchers can fall prey to fantasy and superstition. Wait, did you just hear something giggle? Hear something giggle? Was it myself? Ooh. Hear it? It's spreading over my stuff, my body. 4 armor, 6 resistance. Sweet. Alright, what else we got? Something over here somewhere? Thank God for tab, I gotta tell ya. 70 shins, a sweeping glove cipher, and a starsight oddity. Enemies that target enemies in small area around caster. 20 energy damage. Push all enemies in range back a medium distance with a chance to deal damage if they are pushed into an obstacle. This glove of ornate heavy steel is covered with runes that conjure a strange sense of alienation. With a sweeping motion, you can drain the energy from the glove to fling multiple nearby targets backwards. The joints are very flexible but vulnerable to strikes from weapons. Okay. So I guess it's 20 energy damage plus a chance to deal more damage if they're pushed into an obstacle. Or 20, yeah, damage if they're pushed. I don't know. So my mystical lore tells me that centuries ago, a minor noble named Cetria lived a hermit's life. Obsessed with purity and health, Cetria banned nearly all visitors to his home and allowed only couriers to take and leave letters. As his eccentricities and fears grew with age, Cetria grew more concerned with undesirables being in his presence. He commissioned a local smith and an Aeon priest to craft this glove out of some of his Numenera so that he could repulse any who came too close. Cetria died alone in his home, the glove unused. No one had found him interesting enough to visit. Hmm. How sad. I want to make sure she doesn't have 2 things, or we should probably be okay, but I want to clear something out first. So it's Starsight, an oddity. These heavy, uncomfortable-looking glasses, they're pretty cool-looking, actually, allow a craftsman to focus on detailed work of some sort. The frames are made of an unknown material that appears to move and shimmer as if organic. The lenses are an opaque black. The sky looks different when they are put on, as if the clouds themselves are out of place, or perhaps out of time. My mystical lore tells me that no one is sure of the Star Sight's origins. Rumor has it that the faces of the wearer's enemies, known and unknown, can be identified in the shapes of the strange clouds. I can get back to that, yes. I have 1. Well, no one else has any, so let's move something out of the way. We fill all stat pools. Let's give this crystal fortress to Custies. So she's got 1 bad, and now I'll have 1 bad.
I'm going.
Or 1 over, rather.
These ciphers are killing me.
It's okay. It's minor. Jeez. So we can't use these, always double check. Okay.
Yes, Chuck.
We're kind of in the way, but I think, yeah, there's only this to deal with. That's a pretty cool looking skeleton. Looks like metal. This little niche hardly seems worthy of its own maw. It's an ancient piece of cracked, hardened flesh. The pocket contains a single human skeleton, its legs partially consumed by the bloom's wall. The bones have a metallic sheen, yes they do, and a faint dusting of silver scales surrounds them. They look similar to fish or lizard scales. You recognize the bone structure as that of a human female, though this woman was unusually tall, robust, and probably very strong. The bones suffered numerous fractures, but they were repaired by a silvery substance that fused them back together, stronger than before. It looks as though the silvery substance emerged from inside the skeleton, and it gradually replaced much of the original bone. Sadly, it wasn't enough to save her. Search the corpse. You lift the skeleton a bit. It's far heavier than you anticipated, and it feels like you're lifting metal rather than bone. Underneath is a hammer of intricate design. The head glows dimly, and a golden chain dangles from its handle. Sweet. Let me search again anyway, though. You find nothing of value beside the glowing hammer. Take. A galvanic hammer. Heavy melee weapon. Cool. As you lift the hammer, you feel a presence touch your mind. A clarion call of fame and power. The hammer's head seems to glow a little more brightly, and it crackles with electricity. It is fabled Mjolnir. Nothing of value remains on or around the corpse. Even the silver scales crumble as you touch them. Okay, well, let's check out this hammer. +13 physical damage, +13 energy damage, +2 damage per effort applied to a max of +8. On critical hits, confers hobbled to all enemies in immediate range. I guess not just the one you hit. So for them is -50% movement speed and -15% evasion, active for 3 rounds. This massive silver warhammer crackles with electricity. It is a deadly weapon in its own right, but its electrical charge will cause additional pain to anyone struck by it. The hammer has a rudimentary intelligence that reacts favorably to particularly skillful attacks, discharging electrical energy in a small radius and harming all enemies who happen to be nearby. Sweet. Based on a story you heard from the Observant Spec, this hammer may have belonged to Chilla the Great. Wow. You found it in the depths of the bloom near the skeletal remains of a large human surrounded by silver scales, which fits the Spec's description of Chilla. We found Chilla. Cool. And her hammer. Nice. Gotta be better than Eretus's hammer, right? Or sword, rather. 10 physical, 10 energy. 13 physical, 13 energy. Now, he's using a medium melee weapon. So I just want to see if he can use... his inability in heavy weapons. Alright. So it's gotta be... Eretus. It's gotta be me! So unfortunately we can't even pass this down to him because that's a heavy weapon as well. Runic Blade of Tol Danor. It is better. What? What'd he say? I wish they didn't have the echoing thing.
What's on your mind?
Alright, well, I guess he liked it.
Fine.
Nothing else. Alright.
Alright.
If you want a job done right,
then head through a fleshy maw. That's cool, these little chambers. And it's something it seems you could easily bypass. Like if you weren't paying attention. Let's rest.
Yes.
Because I don't... think we can get back here. Calluses.
My thanks.
Mm-hmm.
If you want a job done right.
Then you head through this sphincter. Well, that'll be next episode, guys. Thanks so much for watching. See you in the next episode. And, yeah. Check back with us next time when we go down the dried up whirlpool sphincter of doom into the heart of the maw. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.